Hello, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Patty Reiners, and I'm a school counselor in Florida and a computer science enthusiast. It is my pleasure to bring you the 15th webinar in this series hosted by NCWIC Counselors for Computing. Each month, we connect you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS plus X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit your questions through the Q&A feature at the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. We will also be sharing resources in the chat feature, also found on the toolbar at the bottom of the screen. The National Center for Women and Information Technology, NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,500 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women and computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of NCWIT's community, creating a far greater impact than if the institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. The NCWIC Counselors for Computing program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. We wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. We shared their websites in the chat for you to learn more. I would now like to introduce our speaker, Jennifer Childress. She is currently serving as an Albert Einstein Distinguished Educator Fellow with the Department of Defense STEM Office. Jennifer is a veteran educator with 25 years of experience teaching science, math, and engineering in Alaska. Jennifer earned her Bachelor of Science cum laude with a major in physical science teacher preparation and a minor in geology from Humboldt State University, and holds teaching credentials in general science, physical science, mathematics, and elementary education. She has taught a variety of courses, including advanced placement physics, engineering, and math. While teaching at AJ Diamond High School in Anchorage, Alaska, she helped to design and implement an engineering academy for students in grades 9th through 12th, which included teaching the project Lead the Way course, Principles of Engineering. She also helped to found and organize an engineering advisory council with members from the local university and community industry leaders. Thank you so much for joining us, Jennifer.
Good evening. Let me share my screen here. And get set up. So good evening. I'm very excited to be here and to be able to share with you some of those resources that were mentioned at the top from the Department of Defense STEM. And so we're going to jump right in with this picture here of me as a child. So we're starting in the beginning. Tonight, I'm going to be doing two things. One is to share sort of my story and my path, how I got to this place where I am this year, and then also talk to you about opportunities and resources from the Department of Defense STEM. And so starting in the beginning, you can see I was that kid with a lot of freckles on my face there. And I was a little kid who spent, I was either outside exploring or had my nose in a book. Those were kind of the two places where I spent my childhood. And I just want to talk tonight, as we're going through this presentation, about opportunities and people. Those are going to be two of the themes that I'm going to be sort of keeping as a path through this presentation. So we're going to start here by thinking about opportunities. And I'm actually going to start by looking at sort of some lack of opportunities that I actually had in my childhood. And so I grew up in California, as said, but not the part of California that people often think about. I grew up in the very northern part of California, which is very small, very rural. The elementary school that I went to was a K-8. There were about 100 students. And then I went to the scary, bigger high school that had about 400 students in it. We didn't have a lot of opportunities for advanced STEM courses. There were no advanced placement courses in my school. Minimal counseling, which is sort of a bummer. Mostly the counselors were there to try to make sure that people got a diploma. And so not a lot of help in understanding what opportunities were out there. And I was the first person in my family to go to college. And so I didn't have a lot of examples in my life of people who went to college or STEM professionals. However, I did have some amazing people that were helping me to move forward on my path. And I have to start with my parents, because even though neither of my parents went to college, they always had a vision for me that included college. I don't remember a time when I didn't know that I was going to go to college. And my parents really instilled that in me. And so that was an important part of my childhood. Also, even though I didn't have examples of what professionals looked like, I did read a ton. And so I think that I was able to see examples out in the world through the books that I read. Starting in high school, there were definitely some people who were really important for me in terms of helping me on my path. Mr. Wood was my physics and chemistry teacher. And I really do believe that he is where the spark for my love of physics started. In fact, I went back and did my student teaching with Mr. Wood once I was at the university level. And then Professor Thompson at Humboldt State University, he was the department chair for the physics department, and he chose to teach the introductory physics class, which is not often the case. And he was very open about why he did this. One, because he loved the material in that class, and he really wanted new people coming to physics to have that same love that he did. And then the last two people on this slide are Dr. Rocker Heppy and Dr. Diver Stamness. And I knew them as Sheila and Anne. They ran the credential program at Humboldt State University when I was there. And they were such impressive role models for letting me and the other people in the program understand how important it was for teachers to connect with students. And the impact that teachers could make on students' lives. And they really helped me to believe that I could be that kind of teacher. Now, I don't know if anyone out there has been to Northern California, or maybe someone is in Northern California who's out there, but it's an incredibly beautiful place. I grew up in the middle of Redwood National Park, actually in the middle of Redwood National Park. And so it's not an easy place to leave. And my husband grew up in the area as well. But if you listen to my bio there, you maybe recognize that I didn't do my teaching in California. I did my teaching, as we move forward here, in Alaska. And so after finishing up in college, my husband and I were interested in adventure. And where is better for adventure than Alaska? And so we packed everything. That is actually our pickup truck that we packed everything into, put the canoe on top and a couple of bikes, and drove ourselves to Alaska. And we did go with jobs in place. And our first jobs that we had were with the Chugach School District. And Chugach is a fairly atypical district within Alaska. They're a standards-based system for K through 12, meaning that even their high school students do not earn traditional grades, A's, B's, C's like you, or credits like you would normally expect. And so I was able to come into the system and really was given a lot of responsibility and allowed to help them write their standards. I wrote science standards and math standards. I also helped write writing standards, because with a standards-based education, everything was integrated together. And this was I'm just having this kind of foundation at the beginning of my career was really important for me. However, the main part of my job with Chugach School District was this incredible program called Youth Area Watch. And so Chugach School District is both the largest district in Alaska and the smallest, kind of different ways. So geographically, it's the largest. It covers the most area. However, it has the smallest number of students. And so that's kind of an interesting part here. And it's smack dab in the middle of Prince William Sound. And Prince William Sound was the site of the Exxon Valdez oil spill, which resulted in a settlement with money used for restoration and research. And part of the money set aside for research was actually set aside for this program called Youth Area Watch to get students that were living in oil impacted communities involved in the research that was happening. And I got to run this program, which meant that I got to do amazing things around Alaska in the first years that I was there. One of them, you can see the picture here. This is a student who was actually taking samples from a seal. So quite a few of the communities that were affected by the oil spill are Alaska Native communities, where they take part in subsistence hunting. And scientists also were interested in this case in trying to make sure that the harbor seal population wasn't adversely affected by the oil spill, or at least keep track. And so you have scientists who want to gather data, and you have a community that hunts these seals. And so this was an opportunity to bring those two together, I think, in a really amazing way. We trained students, the children who lived in the communities, to take samples from the seals that were harvested for subsistence. And so I feel like that at the beginning of my career, I had such a strong example of place-based science and involving communities in science. I want to also continue kind of this line through the presentation of people. There were three people during this time that were incredibly important to me. Roger Sampson was the superintendent of Chugach School District, and I actually got to interact with him on a daily basis. He is the one who put the trust in me and gave me some pretty impressive responsibilities considering how young I was, but also was always there to support me if I needed that support. Sandy Covey worked with me in the office at Chugach, and she was sort of towards the end of her career, and she was just such a master teacher. She was amazing at meeting students at their level, and I learned a ton from Sandy while I was working there. And then Jerry Covey was Sandy's husband, or is Sandy's husband, and he is a former commissioner of education for the state of Alaska. And having conversations with Jerry, just the conversations were always about the big picture things in education, and that really helped me figure out what was important to me in terms of education and being a teacher. So you might ask, okay, why would you ever leave this amazing opportunity, this incredible position? Well, it turns out that it's not in a classroom. And I became a teacher because I wanted to be with kids in a classroom. And so after 4 years, my husband and I actually moved to one of the communities in Prince William Sound that we had come to know while we were working with Youth Area Watch. And this town is Cordova, Alaska. It's off the road system, as we say in Alaska. You can only get there by ferry or by plane. And as you can see, it's a beautiful place. It's fairly small. The school that I taught at was a 7 through 12 school. And I was half of the science department, and I taught a math class. So as teachers know, that's a lot of preps. There was a lot of challenge there, as I put on here, personal and professional growth over the 2 years while I was here. You could also read that as it was quite challenging, but I gained a lot of experience while I was working there. You might notice the beautiful blue sky that's in the picture there. Cordova is one of the most beautiful places I've ever been on the sunny days. But it turns out that there are a lot of days that aren't sunny in Cordova, most of them. It rains a lot there. And so that also I found to be quite challenging. I moved to Alaska because I like the snow, not the rain. But I do want to highlight here one of the very best things that came from living in Cordova was a relationship that I formed with a woman named Janet Clark. I'm friends with Janet still to this day. And she, I believe, is one of the reasons why I'm the teacher that I am. She just was such a strong mentor for me. She is a teacher who teaches from an idea of community, both within other teachers, teaching as a team, and also just providing support to students so that they can truly excel and do their very best. And so I know that those years in Cordova, where I grew so much, a lot of that comes down to the interactions that I was able to have with Janet. So after 2 years in this rainy place that also was beautiful sometimes, my husband and I decided that the right thing to do was to move back to Anchorage. And so we moved back to Anchorage, and I found my home for the next 19 years, which was Diamond High School, AJ Diamond High School. And Diamond is a comprehensive high school in Anchorage, has about 1,600 students in the school. And it's one of those schools that it just has a really strong sense of community. Many of the staff members who work at Diamond work there for their entire career. It's that kind of school. That you also have a strong sense of community in terms of the students that attend Diamond. Many students who go there, their parents and their grandparents attended the school as well. And so that was a really great place to be able to teach. As mentioned in my bio, I did teach AP Physics. This was something that came to me in my second year at Diamond, and I was still a fairly young teacher. I found, you know, jumping into AP Physics was certainly a challenge, but one that I very much enjoyed. And I was lucky enough to have support from other physics teachers within the district. And so that network was there that allowed me to really become a better teacher over these years. And as also mentioned, I was able to help found an engineering academy. Diamond was the first Project Lead the Way engineering academy in Anchorage, or in Alaska, actually. And I got to be a part of that. And so this speaks to that idea, as I started with, talked about the people, which I've certainly been talking about the people who are important to me, but also opportunities. And all of these opportunities that I had throughout these years led to a number of awards and then other opportunities as well. And what I found in my life is that if you walk through one door, you find that lots more doors open. Opportunities lead you to more opportunities. And so I've been able to experience some amazing things throughout the 25 years of my career that all led me to this year. And so this year I'm getting to spend a year in Washington, D.C. as an Albert Einstein Distinguished Educator Fellow. It's an incredible experience. I get to work with an amazing cohort of the top STEM teachers from across the country and learn from them. We're all placed in different federal agencies, and so I get to learn about all those agencies as well, and how government works and how education works from the federal level on down. And I truly believe that I have the best of the placements within this cohort with DoD STEM. And so the beginning, it was talked about, the DoD STEM is one of the people who helps fund this. And I'm going to talk to you about those opportunities and resources that DoD STEM provides. So I will say that if any of those things, the Alaska Einstein Fellow, any of that that you'd like to know more about, feel free to put questions about that in the question and answer. And I can talk more about that after the presentation. So I just want to come back to this idea that the two things that I kind of think about in my career that were so important to get me where I am today, the importance of mentors, the people who really supported me and helped me move forward. And I would guess that if you closed your eyes, and thought about it, a face would pop up in your mind of a mentor, someone that was really important in your life. And I just think that those people are so, can be so pivotal in terms of how we move forward, and then also the importance of being a mentor for others. And then you can only take advantage of the opportunities you know about. I think back to that, the beginning, that, you know, little kid in those pictures who didn't know about a lot of opportunities. And that's one of the things that as a teacher, I've really tried to do, is make sure that I am providing opportunities and letting my students know about all of the things that are out there that they can take advantage of. And so tonight, part of what I want to do is help all of the teachers and counselors out there know about some opportunities to be able to share with their students, and then also opportunities for them as well. So I'm going to switch gears here. First half of the presentation was about me. Second half of the presentation is going to be about the Department of Defense STEM and the website and the amazing wealth of opportunities that are on this website. So Department of Defense, one of the things that I kind of want to address right at the beginning is that when I, before I came here for this fellowship, when I think of Department of Defense, the word that comes to my mind is military. And I think it's really important to understand that it is not in any way necessary to enlist in the military in order to have a career within the Department of Defense, particularly a STEM career. That there are so many civilian and contractor positions with the Department of Defense that are scientists and engineers. And that is not something that I realized before I started this fellowship. And that is something that I hope that, you know, as I'm talking to people, that I'm able to help people understand. So I'm going to focus on kind of three types of resources tonight as I go through talking about the website. I want to highlight a few areas where you can find classroom resources for teachers. I want to talk about one specific career resource for counselors and for teachers. I would use it as a teacher. And then I want to highlight scholarships, particularly one of the scholarships that's on here. So if you look at this picture here, I'm going to ask the audience to think about, how often do you use these items? You know, duct tape's on there. I'm assuming that duct tape isn't just an Alaska item. We use it a lot in Alaska, but I think everybody uses duct tape, super glue, you know, digital cameras. And did you know that these innovations were supported by Department of Defense research? I think that most people do not. And so this is one of those areas that understanding why it is that the Department of Defense is so interested in supporting STEM and supporting STEM education. So the Department of Defense employs a comprehensive approach to develop STEM talent with kindergarten through 12th grade, post-secondary, and workforce STEM education and talent development efforts. This is known as DoD STEM. And the Office of the Undersecretary of Defense for Research and Engineering provides policy and oversight for DoD STEM. And DoD STEM has an incredible website that you should absolutely know about. So we're going to spend some time this evening exploring this website. And it's a really easy URL. If you can put it in the chat, that would be great as well. dodstem.us. I think it was already in there from the beginning. And this website has so much information in it. There's so much here that teachers, for students, for families, for counselors. There's no way that I can go over all of it tonight. And so again, I'm going to try to highlight resources, a couple resources for teachers, career resources for counselors, and then that scholarship opportunity. So across the top here, I think my cursor will actually show here. So across the top of the page, there are 5 pull-down menus, one for participate, one that says explore, one is meet DoD STEM, about, and then for the media. And I'm going to focus tonight on the participate and the explore tabs and show you a few things from those parts of the website. So under the participate tab, if you pull that down, that first section there just takes you to a landing page for the participate section. And then you have opportunities, online resources, calendar, and the Smart Scholarship Program. I'm going to start by looking at some online resources, or at least show you kind of what you can do with the online resources part. At the very end, I'll come back to that Smart Scholarship Program. So the online resources tab, this is a great place for finding all kinds of resources for teachers. I personally would have found this such a valuable resource as a teacher in a classroom. So on the page, I've sort of taken a couple of screenshots here to show you, but on the website, you would find that there are these two little tabs right here. And one of the tabs says the partners. And I'm going to click. And so these are many of the partners that are actually on this website that you can find resources from. And what you can do here, which is really powerful, is you can actually filter based on what it is that you are interested in, what you're looking for. So, for example, perhaps I was looking for an activity for my classes, but I wanted to make sure that there's a video that went along with that activity. And so I put in activity and video, and I came up with 9 results that then I could go and explore. I could have also filtered this down by what age level I was looking for. And so this is a great set of resources where I could go and find wonderful things to be able to do with my students. There's also the second one over here is federal agencies. And that's not a filter situation. That's more of this is a one-stop shopping place for you to be able to access online resources from all kinds of federal agencies. So if you went to that section, you'd be able to then see lots of federal agencies with links to their different online resources. All right. So I'm going to go back to that first page again, the DoD STEM, and now we're looking at the explore part. So that was under participate, and now we're coming back to explore. And there are two pieces here that I wish that I had known about as a teacher, and I can't wait to go back and use these in the classroom. The first of them that I'm going to go over is the video library. So that's the third one down, and then I'm also going to show you the STEM careers page. So after the pandemic, one of the things that I found kind of during the pandemic as I was trying to really engage with students, I found that I wanted to use videos more often with them, but I didn't want to show something that was really long. I was looking for things that were short, engaging, would pull kids in. And I wish that I had known about this video library. So the video library has a bunch of different videos that are actual Department of Defense scientists talking about their careers. And so I want to show you one here. And I'm going to ask you just to have a little patience with me here with this. I'm going to get it pulled up, and I have to stop sharing my screen and then share again. And I did practice this, so I'm really hoping that we get it to come up right. Okay, so we have that. I'm gonna click here. Perfect.
When I think of science, I am just filled with joy because it is incredible. It's cool as heck, and also it can help a lot of people. I am a sophomore at Harvard currently, and I'm still continuing the research that started when I was in middle school, actually. I was actually on vacation, and I was taking an airplane ride with my family, and I was blessed with the window seat, and I look out to my right, and I see giant white bands of air moving over the wings, and it turns out it was just condensation in the air. It made me realize that I had no idea how airplanes flew. I think I kind of just thought it was magic.
So I'm going to stop there. I kind of think that many of my students thought that flight probably was magic as well. Let me get back here. And so if I was a teacher, or when I was a teacher teaching about flight, this is exactly the kind of thing that I would have wanted to start my unit with. And so there's this video here that is engaging. It has a person that my students may not have thought that that's what a scientist looks like. And so it would pull them in to, okay, this is someone who, if you're interested in flight, this is something that you could do as a career, learning more about flight. And so there are a bunch of these videos. They all have real people. You can see that they're high quality and they're something that could be easily used in the classroom. The next part here that is also under the Explore tab is the careers. And I love this page. This is my favorite part of the DoD STEM website. So you can see, and I'm going to go to the website for this part as well. So I'm going to ask for your patience. Sorry, click correctly there. Ask for your patience again as I pull up the website. Okay, so this is the actual website, and you can see that there are a variety of different STEM careers here, from biology, cyber, engineering, all the way to space. I chose physics because physics is awesome. And so I would often have students who took my physics class who would be really interested in physics. And they would say, I love physics, Ms. Childress, this is an awesome class. But if I studied physics, what would I do? What can you do with a physics degree? And, you know, I had some answers for them, but oh, I so wish that I had had this website, because these are all the things that you can do with a physics degree. I don't know what all of these necessarily are, so what does it mean to be a solar physicist or to be a laser engineer, a biophysicist, an acoustic physicist? I just think that it would have been so much fun to have a conversation with students about what would it mean to be these, to do these kinds of things, to have this type of a career. And so I think this would be a great resource for counselors, that if you have students coming into your office who say, I'm kind of into my physics class, is that something that I could go and study? And sure enough, you could pull this up and say, well, let's look, here are some different things you could do in physics. Are any of these of interest to you? With that, gets better. There's actually, again, another video here, a short clip that you could watch of someone who actually has a physics degree working for the Air Force Research Laboratory. And then even more, there are these opportunities at the bottom of the page. So if I had a student who was interested in physics, we could talk about what are possible careers that you could do with a physics degree. We could look at a video together about someone who is actually a physicist. And then we could look at some actual real opportunities that that student could take advantage of in the area of physics. And again, this is there for every one of these areas in STEM. And so I feel like this is such a powerful part of the DoD STEM website. All right, get back. Okay, and if I've done that all correctly, that is the last time I need to go back and forth, and hopefully that's good. Okay, so moving on from those, the last thing I promised to talk to you about was scholarships. And I do want to highlight one of the coolest scholarship programs that I've learned about in this time that I've been with DoD STEM, and that is the SMART Scholarship Program. So that again is under that Participate tab and is at the very bottom. And the SMART Scholarship Program actually gets its own website. And I'm not going to go to that website right now, but it's up there on the page, and hopefully they'll put that into the chat. SMART Scholarship Program offers scholarships for undergraduates, master's, and doctoral students that are pursuing a degree in a STEM field. And it's such a powerful program. I wish that I had known about this for my students. It's not just a scholarship. Not only do students receive scholarships for full tuition, the students who are accepted into this program, they also get an annual stipend. And I just, this is so important in terms of, we all know the students who, you know, they want to pursue that degree, but financially they just are struggling. And so this would be so incredibly helpful to them. There also are internships associated with this program. And so the students who are involved in it are able to have hands-on real life experience in the field that they're studying. And then when they finish up their degree, they're guaranteed a career. They get a job with the DoD and Department of Defense. And again, I want to emphasize that this is not enlisting in the military. This is a civilian job with the Department of Defense in whatever area of science or engineering they have studied. And so I know that I would have shared this with my students, and I would encourage anyone out there to share this with students who are interested in STEM in any way. The applications for the next cohort will come, it'll open up again in August. And I do want to point out that students do have to be in their second year of college in order to take part in this program. But it is something to make sure that students know about. So the SMART program is one of the most powerful things that I've learned about at the Department of Defense STEM. Okay, that was a lot. I'm watching my timer. There's like 31-ish minutes here, but I do want to just summarize kind of the takeaways from DoD STEM. I came at you with a lot of stuff. I hope that I piqued your interest. I made you want to go to that DoD STEM website and learn more about what's there. Really take a look for those resources for the classroom, those scholarships, internships, fellowships. They're a thing for students. There are also opportunities for teachers in terms of professional development and fellowships. And then just all kinds of opportunities on that website for teachers, students, and counselors as well. And I'm going to finish up here with that same slide that I had kind of partway through, just that idea that you can only take advantage of the opportunities that you know about. And I hope that from this presentation, you now know of a place where you can go to find a whole bunch more opportunities for yourself and for your students. And the last piece I just want to finish up with here is that importance of mentorship. The people who really allowed me to become the teacher that I am today and to take advantage of opportunities. They're so important. And I think that all of us act as mentors for our colleagues, for new people coming into our profession, and then also for students. And just how important it is to support people, to help create that sense of belonging in STEM. I just know that we all can do that. And I encourage you to make sure that you're intentionally doing that as you're going through your days. Thank you. I will stop sharing now.
Jennifer, you did such an awesome job. I feel like we've learned just so much. So there are a couple of questions that we'd like to ask that the audience has asked. The first one, and I think that you touched on it again towards the end of your presentation, but they were talking about civilian careers. So the question is, my students don't need to go into the military to work for DoD.
Correct? Yes, that is correct. So, I will use an example. So one of the places that I've been able to visit since I've been here is the Naval Sea Warfare Center at Carterock. And that is a place where they test all kinds of boats for the ships, submarines. They have an amazing pool where they actually do the testing there. And all of the people who work there are civilians. And so there is one person who is enlisted military and he's kind of at the head. And then everyone else who works there is a civilian. So I think that that's a really important thing to understand that I didn't know before I started this fellowship.
So speaking of the fellowship, one of the questions is, can you tell us about the Einstein fellowship that you talked about? Are you away from your family right now during this time? And if you have any kids, because one of the attendees said she wants to apply for it, but she has young kids still at home, and that's a commitment. So if you want to expand a little bit more about that, that would be awesome.
Sure. So the Einstein Fellowship is a one-year fellowship for teachers, STEM teachers, so math or science. or actually computer science as well. I have definitely learned that computer science doesn't necessarily fit under the science. It is its own special thing. The different fellows all kind of approach how they deal with their family in Washington, D.C. differently. And I've seen it done in lots of different ways. It is a commitment. You have to live in Washington, D.C. in order to do the fellowship. And so I was lucky enough to have my husband be able to come and join me here. I don't have children. And so he's able to be here with me for this year, which is wonderful. Some of the other fellows, their husbands were not able, or wives were not able to come and join them. Some have families that, you know, are maybe a little bit nearby so they can go back and forth, and families have stayed back home. I know that there are also fellows in the past, and then at least one this year, who brought his family here. And so that is certainly, you know, relocating to Washington, D.C., if you can make that an awesome thing for your kids to live here for a year, there are amazing opportunities. So it is a commitment. People sort of take that on in different ways.
Wow. And that's a lot. That really is a commitment. All right. Your next question, Ms. Jennifer, are there internship opportunities for practicing teachers to learn through the research? And are there opportunities for elementary to grade 5? So we're talking more of the elementary, on the elementary end.
Yes. So they're definitely on the website. There are certainly opportunities that are geared towards those elementary age students as well. And I'm assuming that they mean through the DoD STEM.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so there are definitely opportunities for elementary. And a lot of the conversations that I've been involved with recently are looking at that idea that we have to start earlier with STEM. And, you know, for a while it was looked at that it was should be done at the high school level. And then we figured out, okay, really we need to be getting the kids at the middle school level. And then it was like, and now people are starting to realize, okay, but we also need to make sure that we're attracting them at the elementary level as well. So there are definitely opportunities for K through 5 in that space as well. There also are opportunities for teachers, and there are internships and fellowships and professional development that involve teachers as well as students. So there's so much there.
I would have to second the elementary education, because I'm actually a school counselor in the elementary school, and we really are the foundation. We have to start here. And I feel like especially encouraging people, and especially our girls, to go into the STEM careers. Because if we don't encourage them here, when they're in high school, physics, they might not even be taking a physics AP class for sure.
Right.
So here's your, I'm so sorry, Jennifer.
No, go ahead. Yes, I was just agreeing with you.
But, And I could talk about that all day long, so I will try not to. But so your next question is, what advice would you give to high school students today? Does DoD STEM have a high school mentoring program? Oh, that's a good question.
Oh, so
advice, and then do we have a mentoring program for them?
Okay, so advice that I would give, that's a good question. I think that one thing that I think is really important for students to do is to try to find opportunities where they can actually interact in the areas that they're interested in. Because I think that sometimes students don't necessarily, they think that something either sounds great or doesn't sound interesting, you know, and so getting out there and actually having that hands-on experience. So taking advantage of as many internships or mentorship opportunities or the ability to visit places where they can actually see people in their jobs. I think talking to people, finding out what their jobs entail, allows you to really have a better understanding of what that's going to be, and to not be intimidated by math.
Yes. How do we encourage our girls, especially, to not be intimidated by math?
I think part of that is understanding. And one of the programs that I helped develop at Diamond was a program called Smart Girls Rock, where we brought in women engineers from the community and had kind of a speed mentoring day where girls were able to interact with those women from the engineering community in Anchorage. And over, so many of those women talked about that you have to be good enough to get through the math classes, but you don't have to excel at it. And that's not the most important thing. And that to not let this intimidation from math keep you from doing something that you really love, that you can get support, you can get help, and you can get through that. And so I think that so often we allow ourselves to just think, okay, math is going to be sort of that gatekeeper and it doesn't need to be.
I think that's such great advice. Okay, your next question. What are you most excited about as an Einstein Fellow? And are there special projects or research that you're working on right now?
So one of the things that I'm really excited about is doing things like this. And so I get to go to a number of different conferences over the next couple of months and share about DoD STEM. And so I get to go to NSTA and ISTE conference, and that idea of being able to get the word out about DoD STEM and all of these resources that are there is one of the things that I'm really excited about. I also just am learning so much in terms of what is being done at the federal level for education and the challenges with that as well. And so I'm really enjoying, though, that aspect of the fellowship also. And I'm not sure if there was a second part to that question.
Are there special projects or research that you're working on?
There's not necessarily research. One of the things that I am wanting to work on in this time is just the idea of increasing ways to increase the number of girls taking physics. And so if you look at the life sciences, we've kind of caught up in terms of the number of women in those fields, but we're still really far behind in terms of parity between male and female with physics, engineering, and computer science are the three areas that we just haven't really made a lot of gains. And so I am interested in trying to do some research into, okay, why is that and how can we change that?
So I was reading that the U.S. Department of Education now, they've created this new STEM project, this new STEM initiative. Yep.
You belong in STEM.
Yes, you belong in STEM. And I love the fact that this is going to excite so many girls to go into STEM. So many people that have not thought that this is a career for them. So are you part of that project too, or that's not?
I am... Yes, sort of. So I was able to attend the You Belong in STEM event that happened here in Washington, D.C. And I actually was able to present on behalf of the Department of Defense at that event. And so, yes, I was able to be there for that. And then DoD STEM has made commitments towards that effort as well, the You Belong in STEM effort. So, yes.
I feel like you are at such a perfect spot in your career right now because you're right at the cutting edge of all of this expansion of great STEM careers for women.
I am really energized and excited by seeing how much STEM is being discussed at the level and the importance of STEM education. And then definitely the looking at diversity and inclusion in STEM is certainly something that it's being discussed. People are talking about how do we make this better? And I'm excited to be able to be a part of that.
And we appreciate that you're a part of that and you're fighting for all of us.
Yes.
Okay, we have another question for you. As an attendee in a STEM, as a STEM supervisor, is the fellowship program available only to educators? Or is it only teachers or is it educators? Because counselors are considered educators. And sometimes I'm instructional and so, you know, but
right.
Who is it available to?
Is this I'm assuming the Einstein Fellowship.
Yes, ma'am.
I believe that the Einstein Fellowship is only for STEM teachers who are in the classroom. So, yep.
Yes.
I think that is specific.
Okay, well, that kind of knocks out the counselors, but okay. What are you excited to bring back to the schools in Alaska after your fellowship? Because your fellowship only lasts for a year, and then you take all this knowledge back to Alaska. So this is my question. So you're kind of on a sabbatical right now while you're doing your fellowship?
I am. I'm actually at a point where I'm probably changing a bit what I'm going to be doing after this year. So I probably won't be going back to the same high school that I was teaching at. So things change there. But as to taking things back to Alaska, one of the things that I'm really excited and I've been learning a lot about it are a couple of programs that work to bring STEM to students who are in communities and environments where it's really difficult for them to have high quality STEM instruction. So in Alaska, we have a lot of schools that are K through 12 schools with maybe two teachers. And so those two teachers have to be generalists across all of the areas. And so what are ways that we can help make sure that the students in those schools have opportunities to really have high quality STEM instruction and get exposure to those different fields?
I think that is awesome because I'm originally from South Dakota. So I feel like we're not a populated state, not like Florida is, but it's a struggle. That is truly a struggle. And how do we find the solution to that struggle? Yeah. So this is the last question.
All right.
Sadly, I can't believe our time is almost up. But our last question, as a school counselor, I want to know, how could your teachers and counselors have supported you more? Oh, I want to know this answer too, because you talked in the beginning how you did not feel supported by your counselors at all. But I did write down for my question that Mr. Wood sparked your interest. So I was curious what he did to spark that. But what can we do as educators and as school counselors to support our students as they're going through their journey more?
I think that just one of the things that has been really important to me, I guess I'll say two things. One, okay. So sharing with students my paths and the things that I've chosen to do. So one, I let students know when I was applying for the fellowship because I wanted them to be able to see that I was willing to take this risk and put myself out there and look for these types of opportunities. And I also have shared with students that I didn't take advanced placement courses in high school, and I managed to still get through a science degree at the university level. And so I think that being able to share kinds of those stories with students is really important. And then also being able to help them see and support them in understanding that there are these opportunities that they can take advantage of. And sometimes it's just as much as saying, I think that you would be good at this. You should try this. Or are you interested in this? Maybe this is something that I could help you figure out if you can do or not. Can I help you with this application? And I really feel that sometimes that little push from someone can plant that seed that then will lead to who knows where. And I think that that's an important aspect of teaching.
I 100% agree with you. And I really think that when we're consciously asking those questions, we're like thinking about what kind of questions are we asking our students? I 100% agree with you. I think that that's where it starts. It has to start here and say, and for us to say, I think you would be great at this.
Yes.
We have to encourage our kids to feel like they're great at this.
Yes. Oh, very much.
Jennifer, I have so enjoyed being the host of our program this afternoon or tonight, I guess now. So I guess that's all the questions that we can take. I know that there's probably going to be lots more questions, but I noticed that you'd put your,
I did.
Your email address. Is that correct?
Okay. Yep.
So I don't know if you feel comfortable sharing that again.
Okay. I think I can put it in the chat. I can put it in for the panelists and then I bet they can put it in for
everyone. Okay, perfect. All right. Well, thank you, Jennifer. Really, we have learned so much from you And I feel like the fact that you went to Alaska and did all of these wonderful things is just awesome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I've had a wonderful time this evening. I've really enjoyed sharing all this information.
All righty. Well, we hope that all of the folks who are watching our webinar this afternoon or tonight, we hope that you'll be able to join us for our next two webinars in February, or you can always go and view the past webinars by going to the link in the chat. And lastly, finally, look out for the survey in your email within the next few days. Responding to the survey will enter you into a drawing for a $100 gift card and resource kit. We thank you for your responses and for joining us today, and we hope that we see you in the next webinars in February. Thank you so much for joining us today.